My name is Christoph Dorbeck. I'm a principal solutions architect at Red Hat, which basically makes me a sales guy, but I don't do account negotiations or any of that. I'm just the technical part of the sales team. I've been with Red Hat for 10 plus years now. I spent 18 years before that doing various IT Unix administration jobs, so like a lot of you guys. I've been through the fire of trying to support large scale deployments of Unix platforms. I got involved with Linux, you know, right around 93, 94 when it first showed up on the internet when I was working at the university at the time. So today's discussion, we're focusing on systemd. Systemd, as we'll hear about in a minute, is a major change in most Linux distributions now. So for a lot of us who have been dealing with Linux for a lot of years, you open up a new, brand new box of Red Hat, CentOS, SUSE, Ubuntu, almost all the major distributions have made the change now. The most uncomfortable thing that you're going to have to deal with is that the old-fashioned RC scripts, the things like RC local, those have all kind of been deprecated. So everything you know about how the system starts and how the system shuts down kind of needs to get refreshed.
Meanwhile, I admit that there are responses like the Ruans who are basically deliberately doing a Linux distribution that has all systemd bits ripped out. So there's
sure.
definitely a fair bit of controversy, and there are efforts to, at the very least, stall systemd. I don't know whether they will actually, whether it will really gain traction.
I think the I'm not a developer. I wasn't involved in the politics early on, but you certainly heard about it. For a lot of administrators who had the comfort and the feel and the whole mindset of keep it simple, System 5 init was that philosophy. And for a lot of administrators who were involved in Unix in the 80s and the 90s, it's what we grew up with, so it was secondhand. For kids coming out of school and trying to understand System 5, and they're familiar with other, other operating systems, it wasn't as easy. So the other problem is consistency, scale, performance. There were things that init wasn't addressing because it was keep it simple. And so Red Hat made the switch. You'll see a history in a few seconds, a few years ago. And then when Red Hat made the conversion, it was within the next year that all the other major distros made the same switch. There's always going to be the, I got to do a different kind of distributions for sure. I mean, just like the scientific Linux that is real time, there's all, everybody's got a niche plan. But for the most part, all the major distros have made the change. So let's talk about what systemd does. And this is largely among the first times that I'm going to give this presentation, so I have my notes. So I'm looking here. It should help the microphone because it keeps me off point down. That way I won't have to keep looking back. So, again, what is systemd? It largely replaces init, and literally it's the first process that starts the operating system and it's the last process when it exits. So, we'll go through how system 5, system 5 init worked, and then how systemd works. So, let's review again what initd was. So, back in the 1970s, Unix, it was the process that basically kicked off after the kernel was first loaded. And init fired up, and then you had a configuration file like initcab. You had a series of scripts that were installed in init.d. When you branch from BSD to system 5, it introduced the various run levels. Then you had the possibility of putting scripts into rc.local. And if this doesn't make any sense to you because you've never seen it before, you don't want to learn it, so we'll move on. But this is what systemd replaces, is all those things that you dealt with when the system came up. Yeah, so, why replace it? Again, it was kind of aging. It wasn't really maintained all that much. Red Hat was using a System 5 variant called Upstart in RHEL 4 and 5, 6. It had some minor advancements to help speed the boot up processing, that kind of thing, but it really couldn't do something outside of a little bit of trickery to to make the system perform any different than old system 5 did. Lack of standardization, and that simply means because it's script enabled, every admin could go in and write the script however they feel to start up and shut down services. So this left a lot of systems with customizations where the next admin came in would now have to kind of unwind how the previous admins thought and wrote scripts. And that also led to a lot of buggy behavior. And it wasn't just administrators, it was your third party vendors. You know, HP would do RC scripts their way, IBM would do them their way. Somebody chooses Corn Shell, another guy chooses Bash. And there's a lot of areas where things just were prone for problems. Another thing was it's single threaded, which means as the system was coming up, it's one thing at a time. It's start the network, start the storage, start the X, Y, and Z. And if there were dependencies among the various services that they were trying to start, that wasn't really a function of a NIP to figure out. But again, administrators would get crafty and embed things in the shell scripts and then sort of make things work, and eventually it would break or it wouldn't carry over what happened. And that's the last point here, right? It's unable to represent complex relationships. You know, in today's modern systems, especially when you're looking more at virtualization platforms and things like Docker containers, you have to be able to express services along with their requirements, the dependencies, and the services that they provide to other potential services. So again, things were, and it was kind of falling apart, and we need something else to kind of step in and become the super process to manage everything else. So let's take a look at what an init script looks like. So this is old fashioned. If you look into any old system, so in this case, if you have a login on the old boxes here, this is client one, this is client four. If you go to etsy, rc, redux.d, oops. You'd find this hodgepodge of links and scripts that basically point you to places. And if you picked any one of those and catted them out, it would essentially look something like this. And what is it that we see in this file? First thing you see already is it's sourcing another file at the top, which is a list of common functions. Then you have a bunch of variables, then you have these concepts of lock files and run files, then you have functions to start and stop stuff, and it continues on. Then there's a function to reload stuff, and then you got a whole case statement to evaluate what your parameters are that the user's passing. And if you imagine that every one of your run scripts, or every one of your init scripts has the same kind of code duplicated over and over again, there's a lot of room for error. All right, so there's three pages worth of init script that we kind of demonstrated here. So let's take a look at what the comparable systemd unit file, which it's called here, would look like, right? We specify a unit section, give it a description, some definitions of what goes after, and I'm gonna go through a good list of what all these options are here. But basically, we're leveraging services that systemd has already defined. We're passing along a couple of parameters. So everything you saw coded before is now basically provided in a simple config, and the terminology we use with systemd, we call it a unit file, because instead of using the term service, systemd defines everything as a unit, and there's different types of units, which is again what we're going to cover here. So that's about the last time we're going to talk about system 5. Anybody have any questions at least what systemd does? And any questions? Yes? No.
Maybe I guess I have to provide the obvious comment, which is, okay, fine, you are imposing a little bit more structure, but I don't really see any difference from the unit script there. Basically, the exact same things are present, you've just got a different structure, but maybe has a little bit more enforcement than I did, but not really any significantly different for basically anything. and purpose.
Sure, so hold that thought, and we'll talk more about the features of System D, and we'll see if we can kind of bring you over to this side of the camp. So adoption-wise, you know, we talked earlier about how Red Hat's kind of in the commercial distribution to kind of make this leap back in 2011 when Fedora 15 switched over. Officially, Red Hat Enterprise Linux made the conversion in 2014. SUSE followed shortly after there, and then Ubuntu, Debian. So pretty much everybody's in this camp now. All right, so bullet by bullet, kind of like what are we going to cover today, and each one of these bullets will be expanded upon. So System D controls more than just services. We'll cover that. It describes dependencies between the various units, tracks and restart services, so if things die, it can recover them without needing user intervention. Service activation, faster startup and shutdown time. This is a fairly significant topic that I can delve into a little bit. Improved resource management, so things like init didn't deal with processes and have to determine, you know, don't give that particular process as much CPU or memory. If you're familiar with a facility in Linux called C groups, System D manages C group allocations for the processes now. So instead of using something that's outside of the process startup and shutdown procedure, now System D can leverage C group configurations right at the time the resources are started. Improved resource management, so better logging and debugging. This basically points out the fact that because System D is the first process that starts and the last one that exits, all the messages that processes kick off as they're beginning are captured by System D and logged through something called Journal D. So there isn't this window of stuff that goes to the console and then gets lost if the system being booted or shut down. It's there for good. It's backwards compatible, so if you really love System 5 init scripts, you can still use System 5 init scripts, but you don't get some of the other benefits. You know, it's there, you can start up and shut down your process, sure, but you're not going to get the other benefits of being able to, you know, describe your dependencies and your services to, you know, enable better resource control or system start and shut down time. And from the perspective of a new person adopting the Linux platform, it's also been shown to be easy to learn. So, okay, so let's talk a little bit about what System D units are. Examples of units.
Excuse me.
Yes.
So I'm very glad to hear some of the benefits, but I guess not knowing what I was reading, people were sort of flaming System D in many different places. And I was wondering, are there any drawbacks that you would identify at this stage from switching over, other than just people are used
fear,
to the old way?
Fear, uncertainty, and doubt.
All right. So that's just all legacy people that want to start, that just don't want to change? Is that the idea?
I don't know the politics behind it as far as, you know, participating in the communities, but I don't know what the different opinions are. Personally, I had 20 years of doing Unix system administration. I knew one hit. And so when we made the change, I was a doubter. I'm like, why? But you're going to notice, you know, if I get on the console, I'm still very uncomfortable with it because I'm still reversing the parameters between check config and service and things that I'm comfortable and have known for years. But the argument that I can now use one command and not always have to use a combination of PS and go hunt through proc to, you know, resolve parent and child relationships and then look at C group information to figure out where stuff is, I can find that all in simple output from System D. So as I get more comfortable with that, I think there's a benefit. I also think the benefit is as you automate more systems and deploy more boxes, right? The industry seems to be moving into the cloud, and we're no longer talking about running hundreds or thousands of instances of Linux. You know, it's now going to be in the thousands and tens of thousands of instances or hundreds of thousands. And to have something that's a simple, consistent process that has a complete view of the entire system and can also dynamically change the view of the system. And that's the other piece of it. is that you can use systemd to reallocate CPU and memory parameters to a particular process. It can all be driven through a single point of entry. I think there's some benefit there too as well. So it's taken some time, but we'll go here.
On the same topic, about a year ago, the main resistance I was hearing, I'm not prepared to measure it, but the issue was that it had been built up in small, modular, simple pieces, and this was a big, complex piece, harder to debug, harder to maintain, harder to keep secure from intrusions. Any comments on it?
Seems like a plausible argument, but I don't recall any specific security problems. I haven't heard of any major stability problems. So from that perspective, the pros outweigh the gains at this point, from my perspective. Yes?
I would say amongst one group that I'm associated with, it is interesting that the person who seems to be most anti-systemd is the one who is actually the Google engineer who I would expect to be handling the tens of thousands or more instances, and so therefore if being able to handle more systems is an advantage of systemd, he's the person I would expect to be rather more in favor of it, and yet he's the one who's rather less in favor of it. The disconnect there.
It's my perspective. And I'm not trying to argue again, one better than the other. I think both have pros and cons. But this is basically where we are right now. And it could, as all open source software goes, right, usually the best solution wins. Right now, a systemd had something that the NIMP was lacking. I think we could go back.
I guess I'll also make a comment. You're not saying very much as far as weaknesses of it. I mean, you are mentioning specific weaknesses of the holder in it, but you are not saying very much to systemd. One example of one that seen mentioned fairly often was that, in theory you can handle transactional logging, and that allows you to have your log files be very, very robust, except for the fact that, yes, this is a theoretical advantage of the way systemd does logging, except for the fact that it doesn't actually implement that. Again, ends up with one being a little bit skeptical about
To be fair, I don't have a negative perceptions of what's wrong with it, but we'll save some time at the end. I'm glad to hear it, because I don't know. Again, I haven't been involved in the politics behind it. So, kind of getting back to the slides, anybody else have any questions? We're good? All right. What are units? So your traditional services, sockets, mounts, the concept of targets, swap, and a couple more. These are kind of the broad components that you define, and then these components then will define the relationships of what they need to basically start the various services. Get to that. And then as we use the command line tools, we always refer to a particular unit as the unit name and then the type, because you can have some collisions or using the name for both a target type and a socket type. So you specify both. If you don't specify the unit type, I think it defaults to service. I'll show you an example of that in a minute. So in Red Hat's implementation, I think this is also true for most other distributions, When we deploy Red Hat Enterprise Linux, CentOS, Scientific Linux, any of the other variants or derivatives thereof, configuration files that when you install the Red Hat packaging, the config files as they get delivered by Red Hat go into the user lib systemd directories. If you as an administrator want to override and use your own configuration, you put those into etc systemd, and then the non-persistent runtime data is stored in run systemd, and then if you want to do what's called a drop-in, which is augmenting the existing systems definition, you just want to change a couple of parameters and kind of merge the two together, then you drop them in this what's called a drop, a drop-in directory, and that way you can use the system's default but make a few changes. Anything under etc will take precedence over the files that are deployed in slash user. And then, of course, if you make any changes, by editing the files, make sure you do a daemon reload. Okay. So common file options. So you kind of saw an example of what it looked like before. But basically, this is, if you're doing a description, you provide a description, some documentation, usually provide some links to where you can get more information. You specify a set of requires. Things that must start before and after this particular unit's brought to life, things that it wants as a basically a weaker definition of requires, things that it conflicts with, wanted by, required by. We provide a great section in our online documentation. All the Red Hat documentation is available, so you don't need to be a Red Hat customer to go to redhat.docs and download it. So you can go pull the administrator guide down there and get more detailed familiarity with that system. So with service activation, services start up when they're needed. It saves the resources and increased reliability, meaning that you can, systemd will monitor the service when it's running. If it fails, it'll restart it. A lot of things that can happen that go wrong when the services are lost and restarted are kind of sort of transparent because the connections are held alive by systemd. So some things that make services appear to stay up longer. And then also if you're familiar with, everybody know what XInitD is? All right, I'll reverse the question. Anybody not know what XInitD is? Really?
Actually, it's not
XInitD,
it's
XInet.
XInet. It makes a big difference.
Fair enough. So, initd in the old days was always referred to as the super server. And Unix platforms had a challenge with memory because having systems with, 4 gigs, 16 gigs, 132 gigs of memory just didn't exist. We were all battling the megabyte or the byte problems, kilobytes. And so having an FTP server running on a host when it wasn't needed, the advantage of basically having one process running, monitoring the ports on a host, and then only starting FTP when a request came in to talk to an FTP server, that's what init provided. XInetD was XInetD is basically a more enhanced version of it. It also provided things like the host.allowed, host.deny, things that we called TCP wrappers back in our day. So levels of security and also a little bit more structure. So I'm sure back in its day, there was the argument like, why are we moving to this when we have the old platform that everybody's familiar with? But in any case, the argument now made is like, you can put that to bed as well and define those services so that system you can monitor. Resource management, so along with the previous definitions that we saw, there's also definitions to include CPU allocation, memory definitions. If you set up C group profiles, you can build that information into the startup and shutdown of your processes. Who is not familiar with what C groups are? So in a nutshell, it's an infrastructure inside the Linux kernel that basically allows you to set up a profile that dictates that a particular process is allowed a certain percentage of CPU, a certain percentage of network I/O, disk I/O. And so by using C groups, a traditional use case of I've got an Oracle database for production and an Oracle database for development, I always want to guarantee that the production database gets everything that it needs, but with its idle cycles, allow the developers to have what they want, but never let the developers take over the box. So I'm running two Oracle databases in the same box. C groups kind of allows you to solve that problem. That's what it's there for. So in the past, you had to use a set of command line tools that talked through the C group to basically set up a set of profiles, and then you take your process IDs and you marry it into the profiles. So there was work to basically set up C group outside the process, start up and shut down the procedures. So now that systemd is managing everything, you take all that definitions and you put it in one place. So then, again, you can argue that there's some benefit to having the traditional system administrator. How do I start up and shut down my process? It's all in one configuration file.
So the traditional laptop, C groups use it all?
If you're running any variant of RHEL 7, it's on by default. It's a requirement because of systemd. If you're using a variant of RHEL 6, it's available, or any variant of Fedora that's even
Double available being used if you didn't think I'm using how to use it. Open that laptop and install.
I don't know what the other distributions are, what they're doing with it. It's very quite possible that they use it to, you know, guarantee a certain amount of resources for the operating system and then kind of load balance the remainder for your desktop experience. They basically provide consistent stuff and not allow one thing to starve disk I/O or something. But to answer your question, I'd have to know more about what distribution you're using. To answer your question. So we can look at
it. I see it there.
It's quite possible. What version of Fedora?
23.
So it's guaranteed that it's on and enabled because that's post RHEL 7. Now it's just a matter of what is it doing on your behalf. So you'll see an example of what the C groups are by default. So it's going to be doing something. Now it's just a matter of going back and looking at the configs to see what it changed. Anybody know what TuneD is? So,
kernel parameters?
It's more than kernel parameters. Kind of if you've ever made a call to any support line, basically, hey, what's your recommended practice for deploying Oracle on Red Hat? And, you know, for years we'd say, well, there's this great white paper, or go read these benchmarks we did with HP. In the later cycles of RHEL 5, we introduced some packaging called Ktune, and in RHEL 6, we introduced TuneD, and we continued that with RHEL 7. And basically, you install the TuneD packages, and then you get a set of profiles, and you do a TuneD ADM profile of equals network throughput, or you know, there's various profiles you pick from, and then you get Red Hat's recommended practices for specific workloads. So TuneD will also make C group settings. Okay, can't figure out what's the single service, balancing shares and by hard limit. So this is all more pros and cons of, or many pros of using C groups. Killing and restarting cleanly. Who's familiar with zombie processes from the old traditional Unix platforms, right? You've got a process, you kill it, and it doesn't come around and do what's called, you know, harvesting or reaping the processes, and you get stuck with things that are owned by a NIC, but they just don't go away. Technically, I don't believe that's possible anymore with systemd, because systemd acts as a proper parent of all the processes that it starts and shuts down. So it should, the zombie thing is, you know, good for movies, good for operating
systems. I've seen zombies on RHEL 6 and 7.
On 7 too?
I believe I am. Two comments. First of all, I suspect if it was actually a zombie with a parent of one that's
well, either of that is a really old init daemon, or perhaps it is a kernel bug you are looking at, because pretty much any init d after, and even before, even several years before 2000, would be waiting for any child process, even ones that it didn't expect, and would very happily reap them. On the other hand, you can also get zombies of a daemon that, where these zombies belong to the daemon, they do not belong to init the, and so until the daemon reaps them or the daemon exits and they end up getting their current changed to init D, they could hang around that way. Even if you've got system D, if the daemon has a child process that never bothers to read, then you can have zombies that way without any difficulty. Without any bugs, system D or init D. So they very much are not dead.
Okay.
Undead. All
right. Fair enough. All right, so clean start cleaning. Auto restarting, another parameter that you can define in the unit file. Systemd will monitor the process. If it dies, it'll try to restart it by itself. And I can demonstrate some of that for you here in a little bit. Let's talk a little bit about some differences between old and new. So, you know, on RHEL in particular, with System 5 init, if you're familiar with the old service command, we're using the term unit, but essentially, you know, that's your RC script that you're referencing there. So you did like a service HTTPD, and then you would specify start stuff, restart, reload. With systemd, the command line interface is systemctl, and then you specify start, stop, restart, and then the unit afterwards. So just notice that the order of the arguments is now different. So action and then the unit after.
Yeah, unit is usually something dot system.
Yes.
Something dot service, I'm sorry.
Something dot service, something dot target, yeah, any of those unit descriptors I mentioned.
So the names will be a little bit different.
Right. So immediately, you know, one thing you also maybe remember as a system administrator, if you wanted to start five services in a row, typically you would do a for loop or something because the parameter was in the wrong place to define the unit that you wanted to start was then followed by the action. So it wasn't just a simple do these five things. Unless you leverage XARGs or some other, you know, additional tool to execute those things. So in any case, systemctl action, and you can specify multiple units and it'll act on all of those at the same time. And if you're familiar with bash completion, right? If you're using the bash shell, it'll lead to tab. Typically, you type in a file name and then you start tabbing out. It'll complete up until the point when there's a conflict or multiple options. Keep typing. For a lot of Linux commands now, there's what's called a tab bash completion package. So you do an rpm install of bash completion. And then for a lot of these commands, you can do systemd tab tab. And then basically the next available option will come up and you start typing tab tab and stuff. So it helps speed along that process as well. Yes?
Just to disconnect. In most recent systems installing, we use yum and or DNF, but not usually RPM directly. Well, you can.
Sure. So yum, yeah.
Yeah, proper ways, yum. Dealing with different databases. Yeah.
Oh,
yeah. Almost.
We don't need to get off course.
Yeah.
Yum's managing RPMs by the metadata provided by RPMs.
Yeah.
RPMs managing an RPM by trying to inject it and remove it individually. So. Yeah. All right, so people love Star Trek references. So here are some examples. So, you know, if you have your console on client 1 up, you can type in any of these things here and see similar output. Anything that's rel 6, you would use client 4. Anything that's rel 7, use client 1. So, for example, rel 7, let's get out of my full screen mode here. So if you want to type it in yourself, so up top, service, dash dash, status all, you basically see the services that are installed and also some indication of running or stopped. Down below, using a system CTL, specify a target type of service, and you're requesting the state of anything that's only active and running. Or anything that's active, sorry, not running, but active, which means it's configured to be alive on system startup. And then you basically see some output. Also, if you're familiar with the previous System 5 tooling, you know check config. So install the new utility, it comes with RC scripts, you'd run check config to turn it on or turn it off, and then you would use service to start and stop it. In this case, you're using system CTL for everything. So system CTL enable or disable basically turns the services on or off for reboot persistency. And then you can also further disable it by doing what's called masking it. The difference is I can disable a service and that'll prevent it from starting when my system reboots, but it doesn't prevent somebody from using system CTL to start it by hand. If you really want to prevent it from starting and prevent somebody from starting it manually, you do what's called masking, which basically goes into the directory structures for systemd and removes the links. So it's still there, you just unmask it and then it's back and then you enable it. Any questions on that?
Cool.
Examining check config, you can do the dash dash list, and it basically shows you by run level. Anybody need a walk through what the run levels do? No. So your traditional multi-user mode, at least in Red Hat, it is run level 3. We reserve run level 5 to be the graphical consoles, and that would basically try to launch X11 in the graphical desktop. 6 would be shut down. So that's what the run levels are, and so this tells you that the particular service is configured to be on or off at various run levels. In systemd terminology, you're trying to reach a default target, and then the services there are either enabled or disabled. So in this case, this is just showing that the services are turned on or turned off.
So does that mean the concept of run levels?
Kind of. You can draw some parallels, but because targets can include other targets, it's like saying a run level 3 can include parts of run level 2, which wasn't really a concept within it. So system CTL, tab, and you get a list of all the options. So, it's very thorough. You can get a lot of tools to analyze the information systemd stores. That's just a quick sample. And then just systemd also has some, so if you do systemd dash, then there's a bunch of other commands that are also there. Like analyze gives you some sample output of data, like if you want to analyze in the startup process, how long did each service take? You can use this to basically find some hot spots in your system. Took me 5 seconds instead of 3 seconds, what's slowing you down? That'll provide you a way to basically get a graphical output, a bar chart. The CG commands, right, CGLS, CGPOP, give you some C group inspection. We'll go through some of these a little bit later. Systemd dependencies, define the order and also the requirements for each unit. So here's an example of looking at the nfslock.service. And it requires that the RPC bind, the network target are running, After this is started, it can basically acknowledge that the network target, the named D service, and RPC services can acknowledge those things. And then before it runs, it also tries to do remote file system pre-target. So there's no arbitrary, again, this kind of goes back to the init ordering. You go into the etc rc3.d directory, and you see that the scripts are ordered by, you know, kill 0 through 99, and start 0 through 99. And then by where the file names are linked with that prefix defines how things are organized and run in specific serial context. With this, you can build relationships of dependencies so that services that don't have dependencies on other services, you can start them in parallel. And that's basically what yields the faster boot time and the faster shutdown times as well.
There's one problem I'm running Fedora 23, which uses systemd.
Mm-hmm.
And is that the packer process built into the Fedora? And it leaves an NFS connection to the NFS server. And if I don't think to manually unmount that before shutdown, it basically hangs during the shutdown and higher power cycle to shut it down. There's some problem with the order of
that should be above that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I do have an issue on the laptop. Sometimes I shut down. I haven't really done it because I don't really press the button to stop it. But sometimes my laptop doesn't shut down. I use a lot of NFS. My home directory is NFS memory.
Do you hard mount, soft mount?
Most of them are hard mount. I could probably soft mount most of them.
I have the issue with soft mounts too. I have to manually dismount them before I shut down. These are just clients, they're not running NFS servers, they're just clients to.
They're clients to an NFS server?
Yeah.
And so when they shut down, even though the NFS servers are available, they can't shut down because they're stuck?
If something hangs up, it'll, where it can't dismount it, it'll just hang coming down.
And if you connect to the host, do you find that you can, I can't troubleshoot the problem here, but
right.
Just out of curiosity, can you unmount it by hand and then it works fine, or?
By the time it's going down, you can't.
So it's almost all the way through the shutdown process. Keyboard and mouse aren't working at all. That one network connection is still keeping machine from finishing shutting down.
I've never seen it happen with Red Hat Enterprise Linux. If you're using CentOS or some other distribution,
no, I'm
using my SM.
What's that?
I'll document it for you.
You're using CentOS?
No, I'm using Red Hat 7.
Oh, okay.
Last time
I'm totally kidding. That was not trying
to. Last time it happened to me, you decided to leave it for a while to see if it would time out. And I came back and half an hour later, it was still not through the shutdown. It had been like the 10 minutes or so, not for you yet, at the wrong time. After half an hour, that just tells me it's on forever.
Have you tried to configure it, the sysrq? Do you know about enabling sysrq on the kernel?
Try that.
So, especially on a laptop where you've got access to the keyboard, that might be interesting.
Does that still work, even though it's just something else to do with it, right?
Kernel still active at all, you should be able to get something, hopefully. Didn't they? Don't know, because I don't know exactly what the problem is, but chances are if it's hung in something, startup and shutdown, then the kernel's waiting on something.
I got a gray screen.
You got a gray screen?
No mouse, no indication. I can check the logs.
Can you control F1 or whatever to get some text that's completely out of?
Yeah, I usually do a text shutdown. I can probably do that.
Does after ABC, does that mean that those things need to run after this, or this needs to run after those?
I'll have to look that. I'll have to go back and double check. I haven't looked at the big possible at all. Yeah, go ahead.
I'm sure after a report makes sense to someone that, yep, that's probably any dependency system that you're working out with. Do they mean after this starts after those things, or those things need to come after this?
My belief is that after defines this unit can run after these other services have begun.
That's what
that
the
documentation would be consistent
says.
With the requires line just above it in the example.
Yeah. Okay, sorry.
But the thing is, I mean, you can impose dependencies like that using other MID systems just fine. You just impose them in slightly different fashions. With the old MID scripts system, I am unsure how consistent it was distribution, but Debian at least, they were using, they had, apparently it may have actually come out in the Linux standards base of how you put tags at the top of the scripts. You just basically use a little hash marks, and someone came up with at least a semi-standard layout for those tags, so I'm unsure how compatible it was distribution.
Was it your Morse predecessor?
Yeah.
That's the issue. The issue is when you have, let's say I have a whole bunch of services under the old init, and then I need to insert a service somewhere between S10 and S11, for instance. In a large system, you start running out of those numbers, or you have to rename them or renumber them. And it usually not a problem, you can do it, but as systems get larger and more complex, you really need to have a better dependency system.
I saw something dependent. That was exactly, Debian was using a dependency system exactly like this on the init scripts. Did was have a standard header on all of them. So you can get this without using system.
It certainly would be possible to have a system that would assign the 0 to 99 alphabetical numbers and recompute them after computing a graph.
Yep.
But in any case, having that structure where you somewhere is remembering the reason graph and not just the numbers as in Battle System 5 is a good thing. This is going a step beyond that, and if things are all enabled by things that have already started, then you can fire off several of them in parallel, which is a great time savings on boot.
Well, you can use that. You don't need
that need not be unique to this product, but this is the one that's being presented tonight.
I saw the exact same thing done with Debian. What it did was it basically had everything with numbering it. Basically, it gave it a dependency graph.
Nobody's claiming that this is the only solution to the problem. He's presenting the one that he's prepared to present. We can have a talk on Debian and Init some other night.
Is Debian still using?
The official one is no, but there is. But there, as I say, is that there are steps to handle this before system B was being likely deployed. So I'm just saying.
Back in the 1980s, I had to write a version of it. Before the System 5 for Raytheon systems.
Was it System 3?
It was actually, we had system 7, but it was created pre-system 3. But it was a case where we
system
had
a lot of terminals. System 7 lived in a lot of corners for a long time.
We used NCTTYs, which goes back.
Uh-huh.
So let's not go back in the history. Let's just accept we have system D, and let's learn to use it.
Question for previous slide.
Yep.
Where can I check that these dependencies? Any configuration policy?
Yep. There's some examples of breaking that down here in just a moment. So we're gonna basically track the system startup and work it through backwards. So just a quick demonstration, you know, visually of what the, and this is using the system. So you look at the command. Problem is, I can see the laser here, but I'm colorblind, so then once it hits the board, I'm completely lost. But in black, you see the system D analyze with the plot option, and then it spits the output to an SVG file. So this gives you a graphical view of what your system boot up looked like, and you know, per service or per unit, how many milliseconds things took to start. So that's pretty handy. So to answer your question, like, okay, well, how do I figure out my dependencies? The first thing you do is you define or you determine what your default target is. So in this example here, you know, we're doing system CTL get default. And it's showing us that our default is defined as graphical.target. If you look at the next command, grep-v just takes out all the comments. So we're just looking at the user lib system B system graphical.target. And here you can see the unit definition and you know what that particularly specifies. And what is it that we're looking at?
Is this the equivalent of level 5?
What's that?
Is this the equivalent of the old level 5?
So the graphical target, if you set the default to graphical target, that would be the same as changing my run level default to 5. Okay, so the graphical target requires the multi-user target. Grep-v multi-user target, and that basically now requires the basic target. So then you look at the basic target, which requires the sysinit.target. Looking at sysinit target, kind of just keeps working its way backwards, and we wind up with the fs pre-target, swap target, and basically that's the end of the line. So that's how you chain the overall target, you know, the larger targets together. And so then working front to back, you can basically go back and determine, you know, yes.
If you're running the graphical is there a simple way of enabling console access as well? So I notice when I start up a graphical analytics under KVM, and I try to use Vert console to connect to it, but people connect. Apparently, the PQI doesn't exist yet. But there's no log on it.
Trying to use Versh? No, sorry, I misunderstood.
I created a graphical Fedora VM,
yeah,
and Vert Manager.
Yeah.
And then when that's running, I can use Vert Manager to connect to it.
Yeah.
I tried to use Versh to connect to it, it won't connect. Which basically means that it's supposed to do a telnet, so it's not able to telnet to that system.
You're trying to do the equivalent of Control-Alt-F2? Control-Alt-F3, you're trying to do the equivalent of that?
Well, I guess you could go there.
I have to see. I'd have to
go actually with Vert Manager and Versh to the same thing. It's not doing that. Well, not necessarily the same. I want to be able to use either of them to get into it.
I don't know. I'll look at it. Yeah, this
graphic applied.
It should. I can't imagine why the config would be different. I'm looking at this is also on Fedora.
Yeah. The host is sent out 7 to unify the VM as a car.
Of course, they don't have a RHEL 7 desktop to look at here. I'm still using 6 on this laptop. I don't know. You want to shoot me an email? I'll look into it. Yeah. Interesting enough.
It's an interesting problem. I all my systems are virtual. I can get to the console pretty easy.
But his specific question is, so he's using Bert Manager.
Yeah, he's using Bert Manager, which is different. I'm using VMware, so.
But if you're on a.
Actually, I set up most of my VMs with Bert. I set one of them with Bert Manager because I want to be graphical by it. And then afterwards, when I went to try to use Bert with it, the Bert was perfect. And I'm assuming it was because it was graphical.
Yeah, let's take this offline.
That would be a Bert Manager setup. If you're using Bert Manager, it sets up your client's BMC or Spice port, and I don't think Bert picks that up automatic. So if you're using a text console, it doesn't work that way.
So I have to set something.
If you change the console, and we can talk. I'll figure it out. That's I don't think that's related to this at all.
Yeah, copy me on that because I might have some solutions for you. Although I don't use Bert Manager.
That's just the difference between setting up a client through Bert, a GM through Bert Manager, and setting up a client through Bert. Okay. Where am I? Yes. Okay, so the want directories. User lib systemd, system, and then name dot target dot wants. This is almost like the mapping of your rc3.d directories and the rc5.d where you had all those symlinks in there. So all the services that start for a particular target, those symlinks show up in these directories. So this basically signifies that the graphical dot target dot wants and then everything that gets started when that target's called. So again, similar to previous models, files in here are all symlinks to the actual unit files, and then empty target want directories are simply just placeholders. So looking at multi-user.target.wants, just looking at the directory there, a bunch of files exist, and then if you look into multi-user, hang on, so one looks into user lib, and then one looks into the etsy systemd path, and that's where you see all those links in this for the services that serve. So what I was going to try and get to, because I was thinking that maybe your use case was I'm running graphical console on some, and I'm running graphical target on some of those, and just standard multi-user target on others, that there's probably something in the target wants directories that's missing. But again, I think this is just your problem. Straight up Bert Manager versus version. Okay, so exploring dependencies, you can list all services by their target. Gives you a nice little graphic. Systemctl lists dependencies for a specific multi-user target, and then the dash dash no pager just avoids the more that pops up every time the page screen is lit. Analyzing a boot. So again, this is the systemd analyze. We saw an example of what the plot parameter did before, which gave us a nice little graph. This is just text-based output. Earlier question, are targets run levels? They sort of are, but it's not a one-to-one kind of equivalency because targets can and will contain other targets as part of their wants, if you want to help them. But this gives you a kind of a mapping of all right, run level 5. That's your graphical target. Basic common targets that we provide, the graphical, the multi-user, the rescue target, an emergency target. Let's see what the differences are. In our case, rescue and emergency will require a root password, so it's not like you can use the emergency target to mount up all the local file systems and get access to a box just because you don't want to type in a root password. You still need to provide those. viewing the default target, again, we're just doing the systemctl get target default. We see where, in this case, we have multi-user target defined. Changing that is done with the set default parameter. So you're going to swap from multi-user to graphical, you just do a systemctl set default. That's typically like the first question most people have is, I just installed CentOS RHEL, but I did it through a kickstart and I want to start the GUI. How do I do that? Change the default, the target level. And then if you just look into the directory, you'll see it's just simply.
So that doesn't change anything that's running, that just changes what will happen next.
I think that changes it. I haven't done it in a long time, so I don't remember, but I think if you do the change default, I'll double check. All right, so system CTL changing the target mode with rescue, or doing an emergency immediately changes your target mode. So I think that answers the question. If you do the set default, then change the default mode, and then you can use system CTL to move that. Excuse me. Okay, system CTL list units of type target. So again, you know, one command provides all the output that you need. This lists all your targets as defined with your current installation. Dash dash no pager option just keeps it from prompting for more every time it hits the bottom of the page. Old commands are, you know, shutting down, suspending the system, etc. Old commands of halt, power off, root, etc. have your system CTL equivalent. On the Red Hat platform, CentOS derivatives, you do maintain the aliases, so you can still just punch up power off and it'll shut down the system. If you want to type reboot, it'll reboot the box. Commands like systemd ctop. This is actually kind of interesting. Let's go ahead and plunk on the host here. Like typing the top command and seeing the processes and the resource utilization. This basically gives you resource utilization by C group. Some cases you might have to enable accounting to get those numbers to be collected and show up in some of the graphs. So that, again, you just go modify the unit. System CGLS. This actually provides a nice kind of view. If you're not familiar with C groups, and earlier question was, am I using C groups if I've never touched it? In Red Hat, we've basically come up with the concept of slices and scopes. So you'll see that, you know, I've already kind of scrolled past it. I go back up, is it there? You'll see this concept of system slices right here. So, you know, processes that are essentially owned by systemd or, you know, core system services belong to the system slice. Processes that are executed by a user belong to the user slice, and then there's a another slice that's reserved for like VMs and containers and such. But you can see by way of this tree, like what's where. Slides here on general CTL. So again, you know, it's in this case right now, general CTL or journal D is an additional logging facility to our syslog. It's not trying to be a replacement, but because it's the logging facility that's associated with systemd, since systemd is the first process that starts and the last process that exits, it captures all the logging messages, so there's no blind windows of messages that can get lost or can't get reported on. And since systemd is starting and stopping all the processes, all the standard error and standard out can also be monitored. logging with metadata. If you think back to syslog, right, you had a command line utility like logger, and then you used a service and a priority to define how the message was logged in the syslog, and then you could set it to be like debugging kernel or warning or error or whatever, and then any arbitrary random message. And then if you have to build a monitoring platform, you've got to understand what the messages look like and build incredibly robust regular expressions so that you can capture the right message, and then also hope that your third-party vendors don't change the messaging, and now your filter can be updated or whatever, you missed something critical. It's always been kind of the ease of messaging with syslog is great, but the arbitrary ability to send whatever also makes it a little bit more complex than it needs to be for enterprises, file messaging, logging. So in this case, what we mean by logging with metadata, process that logged the message, the user that logged the message. In some cases, you can also enable checksumming of the message so that you can guarantee that the message hasn't been altered or tampered with. All kinds of additional capabilities that are beyond the standard that logging upload. Improved debugging and profiling. To be fair, it's different, right? We've had a lot of tools to basically analog and dissect syslog messages over the years. Now all of that's just kind of built in, and because there's standardized formatting and standardized metadata, it's easier to sort and hash and look at outputs specific to particular units, as opposed to looking at the messages .log and grepping for particular things. So again, doesn't replace syslog. Syslog is still enabled by default. by default, journal D is not persistent, so when the machine reboots, the journal is lost. You can change that behavior by just creating a directory in var log journal, and then the journals will be preserved. Let's see, things are stored in key value pairs, everything's documented in man pages, collects event metadata along with the message, kind of talked about it a second ago. And then you'll see examples here, just you know how easy it is to filter it and look through the log messages. So basic command line tool is the journal CTL, and then followed by a series of options, so dash F, open the log, show me the log, follow it, keep it up and over. Show me the last 50 lines, show me X number of lines, so show me 50 lines here. Show me the boot, filter by a priority level. And so you have a similar priority level as you did with the syslog. So if you just type in journal CTL with no options, I'll show you what that looks like. Not too exciting, but that's the basic messages that we saw during the system boot up. If we start to add on additional parameters like the dash F, that'll keep the log open. So if things are happening, you'll see both the log messages pop up.
Does the preservation option have a log rolling built in? Keep it only for a few days as opposed to keep it forever?
I don't know if it depends, or if it just creates a new one for everyone.
If the system reboots, I'd like to see why it rebooted, but I don't want to see why it rebooted a year ago Easter.
Right.
Yeah, right now I've got three points
of
logs.
Yes. Are you just checking that for the first time?
Oh no, last time I checked it was 1.5. I'm like,
mine goes back to August.
So yours is persistent as well? Other examples, looking at the log files in reverse order, use the dash R. If you're looking for output for a specific unit type as opposed to just all messages, so this is actually rather interesting. Do I have agent install here? Do I have running in the box? So system, CTL. Is it in a service? Just messages from system, right? Normally you gotta go look in the messages file, you'd have to either grab stuff out or find the other log messages where system keeps writing to. That's kind of convenient. There's a workshop that I do where we set up a web server. We set up the web server to automatically restart when it's shut down. So one of the things we do is pkill the web server, watch systemd, figure out that, oh, it's down, starts it back up, validate that it's up, and it's basically changes its state again. And we basically just watch that specifically without having to watch the noise, the rest of the noise in the place.
What's the unit name if you want to monitor when you're plugging in a USB device? Or that just reads the feed?
I don't know.
General control has a vacuum subcommand. Journal use vacuum.
Vacuum?
Yeah. Look in journal CTL dash dash vacuum. I did a quick lookup.
That's what we do to our Postgres databases.
What?
Vacuum's also used by Postgres.
Okay.
There's a good metaphor. We'll see some additional metadata about the messages itself. Okay, so a couple last slides. We'll just do a quick review. And it's dead, and it's dead, and it's dead. No, I'm just kidding. So, again, we're replacing it. It's here, it works. I'm sure the debate will rage on. Does define a new boot and root password reset process, so make sure you're comfortable with that. Basic new commands and functionality. If you deployed Red Hat Enterprise Linux or some of the early versions of CentOS, you found that we aliased check config and service. And even though the alias was there, it did not deal with inverting the arguments. So you still had to remember that you're on rel 7 and had to flip them around. I think as of 7.2, we actually deprecated the aliases. So if you want them back, you have to go install the package. So if you're trying to proactively get people to adopt it, just trying to support both. Just trying to support both on the same version of RHEL is difficult. It's difficult. Use the new commands. If you're not comfortable with it, do the yum install bash completion, and at least that way you can just tab and see what options you have at every step of the way. If you connect it to my web portal, at the bottom is a bunch of documents, the cheat sheets provided here. I'll have these slides over to Jerry tonight, first thing tomorrow, but the links will be provided here as well.
Okay, I already pulled those three links off and put them on the server.
Perfect. So the cheat sheet provides basic, here's how you did it on rel 5, here's how you do it on rel 6, and here's how you do it on rel 7. It's not just systemd, it's a bunch of other stuff. And then just basically an overall RHEL 7 system you teach. Compatibility-wise, if you've got a handful of self-made init scripts, you don't have to go over all of them tomorrow to work with systemd. But, the intent is start to consider it and move those forward here soon. Hopefully the migration process isn't difficult because everything you were doing in the init script should be provided by the system view core system. Incompatibilities, here's a link to that. This document on converting System 5 init scripts over. Other resources, documentation on Red Hat's webpage, systemd project page, system admin 1 and 2 training if you want to do that through Red Hat, systemd fact, and then we also have some links with tips and tricks. So again, the document will have both the live links. I don't have the URLs here, but you've already got it up there. And that's all I have. We still got time.
Yeah, we've really gone out to lead till about 9-ish.
Yeah. So if you want to fill with the systems we've got open in the cloud, they're here for us to play with. I hope this is useful. Happy to sit, try and answer any questions.
This is more of a comment. So my point of view is going to be a little different than everybody here because I'm more so a developer than the systems. I know some of the frustration was kind of, some of the frustration that came from Upstart. And I know what I faced with Upstart was everybody said this thing is wonderful, we'll do everything, it'll bake bread, it'll be cappuccino. I found so little documentation. There's all sorts of documentation on like how to run Upstart, and I could not find any documentation at all, searching for like 2 days, on how do I make an Upstart script for something that I'm making myself. They spent so much time saying how easy it was, but not enough time telling me how you could actually do it. This seems to be a lot more sensible to me than that. Certainly, Mel's more thought out, and maybe hopefully after the initial, oh, this is different, we won't see the same resistance as
others. You can remember the guy wrote it in Dutch.
That's okay.
The freaky Dutch.
What's
that?
What's his name? Poirier.
Potter.
Yeah, Potter.
Leonard. When we did the Red Hat Summit last year here in Boston, he presented obviously here, but then he was also in New York City the week after doing a LUG meeting there. I tried to get him to come here, but he was in New York City.
Is this more bulletproof and tested than his disastrous audio layer?
Are you talking about Pulse Audio?
I think that would be what I was referring to, the disastrous audio layer.
Sure.
Took a while for it to stabilize. This is a little more system critical than the audio.
Yeah, this has been pretty stable. I played with it while I have not had a problem with any of my servers. The problem I've had, of course, is, you know, switching my brain from, you know, the System 5 init mentality to the system control mentality.
Well, yeah, I mean, it was hard enough for us old guys to get used to System 5, but
yeah,
that's our problem.
I'm running an Arch script that is kind of like go
crazy. You're running a what?
I'm running an Arch derivative
for Parabola, and yeah. So how did you wind up on that distribution? What was the decision process?
I went from Debian to Arch, and then I like trained myself on Arch, and then I wanted something more like permanent with free software, so I went to Parabola.
One of the things I kind of like, and I didn't really know that well, is under systemd, you can have as many targets as you want. Where in,
yeah.
Well, you can do that in init. And System 5 init's not limited to run levels 0 through 6.
How many do you want?
But you can, well, yeah, you can make it. as many as you want, but it gets very tedious. Especially in the some of the days in Linux when Red Hat had the 5 run levels and Debian had 3. And graphics was not one of the run levels.
That's never been true, right?
It was true. Believe me, I ran Debian.
Debian has never. The situation has been, it's just been whether those run levels were used for very much, but they were always available on all of the distributions. They're available on FreeBSD.
The standard, yeah, they work. But the standard run levels for Debian were essentially one.
I think Jerry's saying out of the box, Debian didn't support a graphical run level. It was initially a server OS.
Yeah.
And nobody in the room is going to beat Jerry for being oldest, so don't fight.
I beg to differ. I think Mr. Miller there beats me.
But he doesn't go back on Linux that far.
Well.
and back in the early days, I was a user of Miller Micro.
One of the things I'm trying to say.
That was fourth. That was Linux.
Out of the box, different Unix systems had different concept of what each run level was. Run level 1 was almost universally single user. Run level 2 was almost universally single user, multi-user mode with no network. And then beyond that, you go, because I worked on a lot of different Unix. Run level 3 was usually multi-user level with network.
Basically, 2 through 5 were pretty much variables that were well beyond single user, more or less.
Well,
that's about what.
Exactly. But the definitions.
You also have the variability of Solaris. The run levels were achieved sequentially. So you would start at run level 1, go to 2, go to 3, versus on Linux, you go right to 3.
Yeah.
And so that's why the directories had a lot more kill scripts and a lot more hits.
But the other thing is that if you transition from one run level to another, you had to kill some processes. But if those same processes were supposed to be available, started in the other, System 5 init actually had to check them so it didn't stop and start the service that was already running. So it got interesting at some point.
So here's a question I have. It may not be unique to System View, it may start a question. So when I hibernate my laptop and I restore it, I have less functionality after the restoration.
What did you do?
Hibernated. And then woke it up.
Open up. So you're basically restoring the memory. And things like on my laptop I had the tap click. The tap click memory works up to start and it's like trigger you to the command.
What distribution are you using?
Fedora.
Which Fedora?
23. This was true all the way through. And it was true on System 5, and it's true now. The question is, is anything, is this just a disconnect between the on and the south that I can get that little piece to the story?
Is that on your ThinkPad that happened?
Yeah.
So I have the exact same problem under Ubuntu on my computer. So I've got extra buttons configured on my wheel, on my mouse. Every time I wake up my computer, I have to do sudo imwheel.jsk. Otherwise, I can't use any of the buttons on my mouse every single time. So I guess the question is like waking up from sleep targeting this? Can you handle that? Like when I wake up from this?
Sure.
sure that there's other infrastructure in place to deal with suspend and resume. But I'm thinking back to Rule 6. I don't know if that's changed in Rule 7. We need to have like a desktop guy show up here. That's Badger him. Which can be done. Yeah, like somebody
sounds like our room came back with that specific tool, just didn't think of that in space.
I mean, it's also the, you know, the problems in the past where your sound driver worked great, and then after a suspend and resume, your sound driver is no longer working, so you got to go remove the kernel module and then reinstall it.
Well, you used to have the PM utils where you set up things, you know,
right.
It would be restarted, but this doesn't seem to move the equivalent in system D. But I never would, you know, even the PM utils, they switched over before I could figure out.
Yes.
You know, the answer.
Yeah, well, things like that.
Have you tried the Florida community web pages and try to open a questionnaire and see if anybody can help you? They're pretty active. Most of the Red Hat employees that work on Fedora, they're very active in those pages. You should be able to.
Oh my god, I typed something in the article.
It's already been solved. But not in Fedora.
but I'm sure it was. I'm sure it was. Because I was told to use the system.
And the solution is?
So occasionally such patterns fail to work when the computer resumes from sleep or hibernation. This can be corrected without rebooting by switching to a console and then back again, entering the sleep mode again, and resuming it again, or locating the correct kernel module. Oh, removing it in search. Okay. So those are your options.
Yeah. Oh, I mean, it's easy enough. I just,
that's the kind of stuff we already know.
You know that all been triggered, and it's reloading all the user.
Well, I had a problem earlier where I would plug into the screens here, and my touchpad didn't work. Or I couldn't move my active display over because I had to split display as I fixed that. But it was just unplug the network, physical network, sometimes it won't switch over to the VPN and all my mount points hang on. But that might be my configuration because I've got my home directory mounted.
But next time I present, I'll have a fully functional Satellite 6 management platform to talk about other stuff.
Yes, we can. Okay.
So, again, thanks for everybody. And